Hi, it's Carol Clark, and welcome to Build the Weight Loss Practice of Your Dreams. Our episode this week is all about facility planning, and I'm going to share with you 5 tips for an effective and enjoyable facility planning experience. And you may think that's not really possible, but it is. I have been involved with numerous facility planning projects, both as a consultant and being in the trenches, just like you, doing that. And you can kind of relate it to building a home. My husband and I actually enjoy that process. We've built a couple of homes. We've been in the one we're in now for 20 years. If you design it correctly, it serves you and your family well for years. And it's the same way with your practice and the facility that you're going to be operating out of. So I do consulting on this, like I say, and in my past experience as a hospital administrator, I was actually responsible to oversee construction with a new wing, a particular floor. It was the whole second floor, which involved labor and delivery, mother baby, a new NICU. It was really a lot of things related to women's health. And so I really love detail, as you may know if you've worked with me, and I really love creating space that's going to serve your patients really well and you, not only currently but for years to come. And I love helping people make it a very personalized environment. It's just a great experience. But I'm going to share with you 5 tips that you really need to have in mind if you're thinking about either renovating your location or another location, or building a whole new facility. And the first one is to make sure it is the right time. Sometimes, you know, people can get caught up with like looking at what their competition's doing and feeling like I need to keep up with that. And you may not be ready from a business perspective financially, or also just from a team perspective, to make it a positive experience and a great flow for making that happen. So you want to make sure, first of all, that there really is a need for that. Secondly, you want to make sure it's going to be affordable. So I've worked with large healthcare organizations as they go through facility planning, as well as individual practices of entrepreneurs, solopreneurs, people who are, you know, this is their family business or this is their lifeline. And you do want to make sure that financially you are very prepared, because there are, as much planning as you have, there are typically some unexpected things that come up. Perhaps a city comes in and requires additional zoning, or a new BMP, or the parking lot needs to have some additional work, or drainage, or something related to the facility. Those things creep in, and so you want to make sure that you're prepared for that. So if you are a solo practitioner, you do want to make sure that financially you have, you know, saved up some resources for this, or you have enough saved up so that, you know, in case it affects your income in any way, you aren't going to be, you know, having a big, huge difficulty. Of course, we know that you can bump up your practice in order to help compensate for that, but you want to make sure that financially you really are prepared for this. And you want to make sure that if you're building a new building, that you think about your location. For many physician offices, you're just, you know, you're in a medical office building perhaps, which is fine, or you're with a large healthcare organization and some space has already been set aside for you. If you're a solo practitioner, particularly in the area of weight loss, you can benefit from having a location that is more on a main thoroughfare, somewhere where it's very visible. We often think about physicians' offices more as destination bound, meaning that people just search you out and they will come find you wherever you are. But you can actually have an additional amount of patients coming through from what we call a drive-by, and just from that visibility if you're on a very busy thoroughfare. So for weight loss, location really can make a bit of a difference. So you want to think about that. If you're on a main thoroughfare, you can also add another marketing. We can get into that, but there's, you know, with signage and all that sort of thing. And so that's what I want you to consider first, is make sure it's the right time for doing it. The second tip is to have your vision first and buy-in from all of the partners, if you have partners in your organization, because there's nothing worse than giving your new facility or your renovation, handing it off to somebody else, thinking, I don't want to deal with that, they'll do a great job. You want to have your vision for your practice and make sure that you do have buy-in, because there's nothing worse than having partners who are at odds with each other because they have different goals and different visions. I have been through this on more than one occasion when I used to work with lots of OBGYNs and perinatologists and general surgeons and bariatric physicians and bariatric surgeons. I have experienced this and it is not pleasant. So you want to make sure that everybody's on the same page and that you do have a vision that's driving the activity. Granted, you may be really busy in the OR, you may be really busy seeing patients, and you may not be the first one who's going in day by day to make sure everything's flowing properly, but you do want to be the person who sets the vision for your individual practice. So make sure that you have your vision set and you also have buy-in from your partners. And when I talk about vision, it's not just the it involves everything from what services you're going to be providing. It's not just the decor, I was going to say, but it's like what services are you going to be providing? What do you want your environment to look and feel like? How do you want to serve your patients? What growth do you see coming up down the pike? What planning do you have for that? And how do you want to prepare for that so you're not continually in this facility renovation or planning mode? So you want to think those things through and make sure that your vision is really there. My husband, Tom, he's just an awesome visionary. He thinks about things that I might not, because I can get caught up in the details because I'm such a detail-oriented person. I know the look and feel I want, but he'll keep some of the larger vision. For example, in our home, he made sure, you know, all the hallways, everything's wider. We never wanted to feel closed in. We're very open, informal people. So we wanted to have a very open feeling house. In our practice, you know, he was the one who came up with a lot of the growth things that we were going to include that I was a little bit, quite frankly, nervous about. He had that vision, and then it was my job to help create the budget and make sure that everything, you know, we talked about that, but making sure that everything was going to be feasible, and then we move forward from that. So having that vision is really important, not just from the aesthetics purpose, place, but also from a place of where, what are your services? How is it best going to serve the patient? What's your team going to look like, and what future growth do you want to plan for? So that is something that I mean by vision. The third thing is don't avoid creating a business plan and a budget. You know, sometimes you can go to the bank and the bank is always willing to loan lots of money to you. And they may not even, I'm surprised at how often they don't require a business plan, unless depending on the type of bank it is. But it's just amazing to me, oftentimes they will loan larger amounts of money without a set business plan. You will do yourself a great service by creating your business plan and having a budget that goes along with it. So in your business plans are just so important. When you approach a bank with your business plan all laid out, with your current revenues, your current team, what you plan for growth, how you see that projected out over the next 3 years, they appreciate that more than you would ever know. I don't know how many times we've gone into banks and it's like, wow, okay, yes, we see that you're a planning person and that you haven't just jumped into this. Oftentimes, like I say, they're willing to loan money and it might not be the right time or as thought through. So you want to make sure you have a business plan and a budget set into place, because as you go through that facility planning or renovation process, you want to keep people, you want to make sure that your contractors, everyone is aware of what your budget is and where you have some wiggle room and where you have no wiggle room. So you want to make sure that's well created ahead of time. You will serve yourself so well, and you will also prevent a number of headaches down the road and potentially some surprises. So that's my third tip. My fourth tip is to really do due diligence in terms of your bank, your contractor, your architect, and anyone you're going to use for interior design. You want to make sure that you do search out people that have a great reputation. You want to make sure that you check references and that they get your vision. And you want to make sure that there's not hidden agendas or hidden costs that you're not aware of. So having that due diligence done can make the difference between a really pleasant experience and one that is not pleasant at all. And I know I've dealt with some interior decorators, some really, I have to work with one who really gets me and gets what our vision is, and I have to have them know that that's the case. It's the same way with your architects and also with your banker and particularly with your contractor. So I know when we have taken even like an old 7-Eleven and renovated it, or when we built this new 10,000 square foot facility, or when I was in the hospital and in a large health system, those decisions might not be left up to you, but you do want to have a interaction with them because you're going to be keeping track of everything, you or whoever you designate. So, but you want to make sure you're getting weekly reports about everything that's going on. So you want to do your due diligence, check references, make sure that they have a strong understanding of your budget and that you work well together. It has to be a good working relationship. And if you have that in place, like I say, it can make the difference between a very pleasant experience or one that's potentially a nightmare that you talk about for years to come and not in a good way. So that's my tip, is making sure that you do your due diligence and do check references. The fifth thing is to involve your team. So a lot of times we want to just take it, we think we have the vision, we know what we want, we're not going to involve the team, but the team is who needs to design their own workspace. And you can give parameters and guidelines for that, but you want to have them help with that. For example, when I was in a large health system and as an administrator, and I had responsibility for building out this brand new beautiful space for labor and delivery, NICU, mother, baby, all that, the team was so critical. We actually, believe it or not, I was able to facilitate down in our basement. We had this open space, and I actually built an LDR room. So I built that LDR room down there. We took it, we mapped out what that square footage would be. We actually designed with the furniture company our equipment. We even ended up creating some things that were so unique to us that they ended up putting it into their catalog and offering it for future labor and delivery areas. It's one of those things that the team got so involved that it created this work environment that when it was all done, it not only was beautiful, but it was totally functional for the patient and for the team. It was just a beautiful experience. Granted, it wasn't easy, and there were like some mishaps along the way as we knew what we wanted, but we're having trouble getting that built, but it all ended up being so worthwhile. And it was a really positive experience. And we knew what we wanted to look like, we knew what it wanted to feel like, and we knew that there were things in our current space that wasn't functional, and if we were going to be blessed with a whole new facility, we wanted to make it totally functional. So that was really an important thing. So that's one example. Another example is here in the facility, I had a vision that I wanted everything. I have this thing about no clutter. I do not like seeing handwritten signs anywhere. I don't like to see clutter, even though I know people are busy and you can get clutter. So everyone could design their workspace, but one of the things I had when I worked with our IT gentleman and all that sort of thing is I wanted everything clean looking. I didn't want big clunky computers. I wanted sleek. I wanted no cords. That was one of my things. And they were able to work with that. In the end, it ended up being a great thing. And as I let people design their own space and be involved with how they function in their space and to create it around them, it created not only buy-in from the team, but it also created a much higher functionality. And working with our contractor, you know, we knew that we wanted to take into account the needs of our patients, just like you do. So taking our walls and making some of them angled so that it didn't feel so closed in, attention to all the detail with your furniture and fixtures and your exam treatment rooms and your counseling rooms and your classroom. And of course, having our fitness facility, all those things were really thought of with the patient at heart, as well as the team and how is it going to flow best and provide for future growth as well. And don't forget that storage. We know that's the one thing that always gets out of hand a little bit. I know as I've done facility planning with some practices, it's been really great to be able to look at their space and then really talk through the functionality that maybe they hadn't thought about. For example, I was working with one group of surgeons And they were building out this practice, and it had a second floor to it. And they were actually, it was a building that was existing, but they were renovating it pretty much all the way. So they had created the space, but there was a number of functionality things that really we ended up diving deep on. And that one of them was the practice manager who oversaw all the team was located on the second floor. And so from a functionality, it really wasn't very, she wasn't down there. She wasn't where she could see what was going on and being able to help proactively and be there and be a part of the team. So we ended up redoing the downstairs, working her into that whole flow and moving some other non-essential administrative things upstairs. In the same space, they wanted to add retail, but they really hadn't provided for any location for that. And initially they didn't have a team to help work with the retail side of it. So we were able to work out a space right off the main lobby that was close enough to the front desk and yet still provided for retail there and also for future growth for retail. So there's lots of different things to think about. We also looked at entrances, how people were coming in, where the restrooms were. It was designed so that people in the lobby had to go through the whole office to use the restroom. So we were able to rework it with the plumbing that was there and work out a restroom that was right off the main lobby. So it made it more effective. So there's lots of different details that when you're caught up in your day-to-day practice and taking care of patients, sometimes you don't think of. So making sure you have your team involved in that is really important. If you ever have questions or need help with that, reach out to me. I love facility planning. I know it seems crazy, but I do. So that is actually my fifth tip, which was involve your team. And my sixth tip is not to miss the marketing opportunity for your grand reopening or grand opening of your practice. And it's one of those things that when you do a grand opening, a lot of times people look at it this way. They think of it as, I have this great facility, I have all these things, and they talk about what the facility includes, which is great. But what your patients care about is what it's going to do for them. So you want to turn some of those things into, you know, to say that you have a large state-of-the-art facility is great. But what does that mean for the patient? Does it mean one-stop shopping? Does it mean convenience? Does it mean concierge services? Does it mean that they can actually come there and lose anywhere from 5 to hundreds of pounds? Does it mean that you have developed it in a way that's going to be more a better flow for them? What have you done to really serve them and their needs versus I'm the biggest and the best, come see me? You know, they want to know there's different things that people will pay for. One is experience. And so that experience is not only in your clinicians and the experience that you have, but also the overall experience they're going to have in your practice. They'll also pay for something that is differentiated, something that's sort of exclusive. So having something exclusive that you offer at your practice is another thing that attracts patients. There's so many other things that come to mind, but when you do a grand reopening, have some creativity for it. I know here we had our little 7-Eleven building, and when we built our new facility, the new 10,000 square foot facility, we had a demolish your excuses sort of event that we had, and we actually, it was, you know, create your dreams and demolish your excuses. So we actually had people come into the practice, the old building. We made sure that it was all vacated, and they actually spray painted the whole place with all their excuses as to why they couldn't lose weight. And then we also had them share dreams and use that in our event. And then we had everybody move aside, and we actually paid, and we had somebody come in, and actually they could see all their excuses being tumbled down in the rubble and then carried away. And so it was just this great way to help patients and also celebrate the struggles that they had, but also the success that they had had, because then they could share some of their dreams and some of their accomplishments. And we also used it as a media event, and it was really a great opportunity. So taking whatever it is that you're doing and turning it into something fun like that is really an awesome thing. And then we also had a grand opening here where we highlighted the success of our patients, and we made sure that all throughout the building that success is highlighted in the form of really tasteful, well done posters with patients on it, little stars where we actually had them sign them like they were in Hollywood. It was just, there are so many amazing ways to launch your new practice and to launch a grand opening or a grand reopening. So there's so many ways that you can go with that. But we're actually at the end of our time for this podcast, but I wanted you to take facility planning and turn it into something that is really going to best serve your patients and you and your team and provide for what you need today as well as future growth. So once again, those were five tips for an effective and enjoyable facility planning experience. The first one was make sure it's the right time. The second one was to have your vision and make sure you have buy-in from all your partners. The third one was not to avoid creating your business plan and your budget. The fourth one was doing your due diligence when it comes to your contractor, your architect, your interior designer, and your bank. And the fifth one was involving your team as you go through this process. And the sixth one was don't miss having an awesome grand opening or grand reopening event. So I hope this serves you well. If you have questions, reach out to me, Carol, K-A-R-O-L, at weightlosspracticebuilder.com. If you haven't subscribed yet, by all means, I would be honored if you did so. Please subscribe here or on your favorite, wherever you listen to podcasts, iTunes, Stitcher, anywhere that you have podcasts, you can find Build the Weight Loss Practice of Your Dreams. And if you're not a member of Bariatric Business Boss yet, then hop over and see what it's all about. See what I go into trainings every single week, deep dive. We do one-on-one coaching. I have tons of resources there. And I would love to be able to do a deeper dive with you. It's bariatricbusinessboss.com. In the meantime, continue to do all that you do for the health of yourself, your patients, your team, and your community. And have a great day.